That concludes topical questions. The next item of business is a statement by Nicola Sturgeon on COVID-19 update. The First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Nicola Sturgeon, First Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll give an update today on COVID generally and also the latest data on Omicron. I'll report on progress with booster vaccinations. I will again appeal to everyone across the country to reduce contacts and stay at home as much as possible in the run-up to Christmas Day and then again after this Christmas weekend, and also reiterate the steps we can all take to make family celebrations this weekend as safe as possible. I'll also confirm Cabinet's decision to propose some additional protections in relation to large-scale live events and indoor public places. We judge these to be necessary to further slow the spread of the virus so that we can protect health, the National Health Service and the economy as we work to complete booster vaccinations. And I'll set out further support for the many businesses affected by the advice we feel duty-bound to give in the interests of protecting public health. First, though, today's statistics, 5,242 positive cases were reported yesterday at 14.9% of tests carried out. 515 people are in hospital with COVID, one fewer than yesterday. 37 people are in intensive care, also one fewer than yesterday. And sadly, a further 9 deaths have been reported, taking the total number of deaths under the daily definition to 9,790. And I want again to send my condolences to everyone who has lost a loved one. Presiding Officer, in last week's statement, I reported that cases had increased by 25% in the preceding 7 days and that we would, in all likelihood, see a further increase in infections as Omicron became the dominant strain circulating in Scotland. Omicron has now firmly established itself as the dominant strain. We know from the S-gene dropout indicator that it now accounts for 62.9% of all cases. That's compared to 27.5% this time last week. Omicron is significantly more transmissible than previous variants, and we estimate its R number is well above 3. It is currently spreading rapidly across Scotland, and so the steep increase in infections that was predicted last week has now started to materialise. Cases increased by more than 50% in the past week, from over 3,500 a day on average to almost 5,500 a day. There were increases across all age groups, but the biggest, an increase of 161%, was in the 20 to 24-year-old age group. The rate of acceleration in an age cohort with, to date, lower levels, relatively speaking, of booster protection underlines the vital importance of everyone getting booster jabs as quickly as possible, and I'll return to that later. However, as the booster rollout is completed, and bearing in mind that it takes around a week for immune protection to take effect in individuals, we must also act to slow down the spread of cases. And I want to explain why that is so vital. Firstly, the toll that a rising wave of infections will have on health and on health and social care is considerable. We don't yet know if the proportion of Omicron cases needing hospital care will be lower, higher or the same as with Delta. However, there's still no compelling evidence that Omicron is intrinsically milder than previous strains. However, even if the proportion of cases needing hospital care is lower, as we all hope it will be, a smaller proportion of a much larger number of infections will still have a deeply damaging impact. As well as the suffering caused to individuals and families, the additional pressure on our already stretched National Health Service will be extremely difficult to manage. In addition to that, if large numbers of people become infected, even mildly, the impact on the economy and critical services through sickness and isolation absences will be crippling. Indeed, we're already starting to see this impact. 100 ScotRail services were cancelled yesterday due to staff absence. Theatres are already being forced to cancel shows due to COVID cases amongst cast and crews. And even more seriously, staffing shortages are already being felt across the supply chain, and they are exacerbating the intense pressures that the NHS and emergency services are working under. So this is why we must act. And let me be clear again, this is not a choice between protecting health and protecting the economy. If we don't stem the spread of the virus, both health and the economy will suffer. Now, before I set out the action we must take, let me address one further point. Some ask why we can't wait until we have more data and know exactly the impact Omicron will have on the NHS. I totally understand the temptation to delay, to hope after 2 long years of this that further steps might not be necessary. But firstly, as I said a moment ago, we are already seeing a significant impact from staff absences across the economy and public services. We must do what we can to stem this. And secondly, we know from experience that if we wait until the data tells us conclusively that we have a problem, for example, with hospital admissions, it will already be too late to act to avoid that problem. We must act quickly insofar as we are able, given our financial constraints, and we must get ahead of the data if we can. So the obligation of government is to take difficult decisions to keep the country as safe as possible, no matter how unpopular these decisions might be. So let me now set out the steps we all need to take. Firstly, though, let me stress we are not changing the advice for Christmas that I set out last week. It is important that with just a few days to go, there is certainty about family gatherings on Christmas Day and Boxing Day. I am not asking anyone to change these. However, and I can't stress this enough, please do follow advice to keep family celebrations as safe as possible. Keep gatherings as small as your family circumstances allow. Make sure everyone does a test shortly before getting together. Anyone who tests positive should not mix with others. And given how infectious Omicron is, you should assume that if one member of a household is positive, the others are likely to be so too. Follow hygiene advice and keep windows open. And crucially, between now and Christmas Day, cut your contacts with people in other households as much as possible. Minimise socialising with others, either at home or in indoor public places. Indeed, stay at home as much as is feasible. This is the best way of avoiding getting COVID and having to isolate over Christmas, or inadvertently spreading infection when you do meet up with others. I'm really grateful to everyone who has followed this advice over the last week. It will be making a difference, and I want to stress this point. The steep increase in cases over the past week would have been steeper still, but for people complying with this advice. So I hope we may already be collectively slowing the spread. But it is important that we stick with it. So my first new request of everyone today is this. From the 27th of December, as we come out of the Christmas weekend, and at least until the end of the first week in January, when we will review this advice again, please go back to limiting your contacts as much as you possibly can. Please stay at home as much as is feasible. When you do go out, maintain physical distancing from people not in your own group. And difficult though it is, please follow this advice over New Year. Minimise hugmanay socialising as much as you can. If we all follow the advice to minimise the contact we have outside our own households, we will help limit the spread of infections. So this is the bedrock of our plan for the immediate period ahead. However, while our core advice is to reduce socialising and stay at home as much as feasible, the Cabinet's judgment is that we must also take some further steps to make the places where people might still gather as safe as possible. And that is why we are proposing some additional protections. None of these are being proposed lightly, but we do consider them necessary to help stem the increase in cases, safeguard health and protect the NHS, the emergency services and the economy while we complete and get the full effect of the booster programme. So first, from the 26th of December, inclusive of that date, for a period of up to 3 weeks, we intend to place limits on the size of live public events that can take place. This does not apply, let me stress, to private life events such as weddings. For indoor standing events, the limit will be 100. For indoor seated events, it will be 200. And for outdoor events, at 500 seated or standing. Physical distancing of 1 metre will be required at events that go ahead within these limits. This will, of course, make sports matches, including football, effectively spectator-free over this three-week period, a situation similar to that in Wales from Boxing Day. And it will also mean, unfortunately, that large-scale hugmanay celebrations, including that planned here in our capital city, will not proceed. I know how disappointing this will be for those looking forward to these events and for the organisers of them. But I want to underline why we think this difficult decision is necessary. Firstly, we know that the much higher transmissibility of Omicron means large gatherings have the potential to become very rapid super spreader events, putting large numbers at risk of getting infected very quickly. Limiting these events helps reduce the risk of widespread transmission. It also cuts down the transmission risks associated with travel to and from such events. And second, and this is not an insignificant point, these large events put an additional burden on emergency services, especially the police and ambulance services, at a time when these services are already under severe pressure and also dealing with high staff absences. Limiting large-scale events will help them focus on delivering essential services to the public. So I would ask the public, despite the disappointment I know this decision will generate, to please understand the reasons for it. Second, we intend to issue guidance to the effect that non-professional indoor contact sports for adults should not take place during up to a three-week period from 26 December. This is because these activities, where physical distancing is not possible, also create a heightened risk of transmission. And finally, from the 27th of December, again for up to 3 weeks, we intend to introduce some further protections in hospitality settings and other indoor public places to reduce transmission risk in what are, through no fault of those who run such venues, higher risk environments. I can confirm that a requirement for table service only will be reintroduced for venues serving alcohol for consumption on the premises. And we will also ask indoor hospitality and leisure venues to ensure 1 metre distance, not within, but between groups of people who are attending together. And we will continue to advise, as I set out last week, people that if they are attending indoor hospitality or leisure venues, and remember our core advice remains to minimise this, there should be no more than 3 households represented in any group. Presiding Officer, I know how unwelcome this will be for everyone, but we believe these precautionary steps will help us navigate a difficult period more safely. I'm also acutely aware that these decisions and the advice we are giving the public have significant financial implications for many businesses. Last week, I announced £100 million of support from within our existing resources for affected sectors. I can also confirm eligibility and guidance for the hospitality sector will be published on the Scottish Government website today. Since then, the Treasury has given approval for money that would have come to us later to be allocated now. As I have said, we had already budgeted for most of that money, and so we cannot allocate it now without causing significant shortfalls elsewhere, including in the health budget. Money simply cannot be spent twice. However, we estimate that the Treasury announcements do give us additional spending power now of £175 million, and I can confirm today that we will allocate all of this to business support. The Treasury has also, in the last hour or so, announced additional funding for business. Unfortunately, it would appear that this announcement generates no further funding for Scotland and that any consequentials are already contained within previous announcements by the Treasury. I can, however, announce that the Scottish Government will allocate a further £100 million from elsewhere in our budget between now and the end of the financial year. This will involve really difficult decisions, but the impact of the current crisis on business is such that we consider it essential. So taken together, this adds up to a fund of £375 million that will help support businesses for the unavoidable impacts of our decisions over the next 3 weeks. This is significantly more proportionately than the Chancellor has just announced for businesses elsewhere in the UK. Presiding Officer, while this is significant funding, I understand that it will not fully compensate business. As I said last week, my view is that the scale and urgency of the Omicron challenge requires financial support for business on a scale similar to that at the start of the pandemic. However, current UK funding arrangements mean, firstly, that only the Treasury has the borrowing powers to provide support on such a scale, and second, that financial support at scale is triggered only when the UK government takes decisions for England. All of this means that our ability to act to protect public health and to compensate individuals and businesses affected is curtailed. This cannot be right in a public health emergency. So while today's Treasury announcement may be a welcome acknowledgement of the crisis businesses face, it does not yet go far enough. We will therefore continue to press the UK government to take the threat of Omicron more seriously and to act accordingly. But in the meantime, we will, indeed we must, live up to our own responsibilities to do everything we can to protect health, lives and livelihoods here in Scotland. Presiding Officer, before I conclude with an update on vaccination, let me cover 2 further points. Firstly, it remains our priority, I hope Parliament's priority, to reopen schools as normal after the Christmas holidays. Indeed, one reason for asking adults to make sacrifices for a further period after Christmas is to help minimise any impact on children's education. However, to help ensure that schools are safe environments for young people and staff, updated guidance based on recommendations from the Education Advisory Subgroup was published at the end of last week. Colleges and universities are also assessing any steps they need to take for the new term, and some are returning to a default model of online learning for the start of the new term. For everyone involved in education, staff, children, students and parents, this has been another exceptionally difficult term, and I want to say a heartfelt thank you to all those who have helped ensure that children have been well supported, and indeed to children and young people themselves, for the tough times that they continue to endure at such an important stage of their lives. Second point I want to cover briefly relates to Test and Protect. The current surge in cases is putting significant pressure on Test and Protect, and I'm grateful to all of its teams for working so hard to help break chains of transmission. From this week, Test and Protect will flex its approach as necessary to ensure priority is given to higher risk settings such as hospitals and care homes, where outbreaks can cause most harm. For many of us, this means that if we test positive, our contact from Test and Protect teams is more likely to be by text or email rather than phone call. Please make sure you respond to these messages and complete the online form that is sent. This helps your contacts get the right advice as quickly as possible. And if you are the contact of someone who tests positive, please follow Test and Protect advice. This will help slow the spread of the virus. Let me turn finally to booster jabs, which are, of course, our best line of defence against Omicron, and they are what will get us through and out of this difficult phase, I believe. There has been a significant acceleration of the programme in the past week, and I thank everyone involved. A further two large-scale vaccination centres have opened this week, at Hampden in Glasgow and at the Edinburgh International Conference Centre. Yesterday, 69,135 boosters or third doses were administered. That means well over half now of the adult population has had a third dose or a booster. Last week, I said that our target was to have 80% of the eligible population vaccinated with boosters by the time the bell strike on Hogmanay. I can confirm today that we are now confident we have the capacity to meet that target. But of course, to reach it or get as close to it as possible, we need everyone who is eligible to come forward. So if you have an appointment booked for January, please now reschedule it for December. Appointments will be available right through Christmas Eve and then next week up to and including Hogmanay. So please book an appointment now. Alternatively, check out the location of drop-in clinics and go there instead. Getting fully vaccinated is the best thing any of us can do to protect ourselves, our loved ones and the country. So please do get boosted before the bells. Presiding Officer, this statement in some ways feels distressingly similar to the one I gave this time last year. Just a few days before Christmas, I'm again urging people to stay at home as much as possible to slow down a highly infectious new variant of COVID. But although it might not feel like it, we are in a much stronger position than last year. We have had far fewer restrictions in place for much of this year than was the case in the previous year. Christmas Day this year will be more normal than last year. Most importantly of all, a rapidly increasing number of adults is now protected by three doses of vaccine. And all of us, as individuals, know what to do to protect ourselves and each other. So please make sure you do all of these things. First, get fully vaccinated as soon as possible. Second, test regularly. Our advice, of course, is to stay at home as much as possible. But if you are meeting other people, test before you go every time and test as close to going as possible. And this is really important, of course, for family gatherings on Christmas Day or Boxing Day. And finally, take all the other precautions which can help to make a difference. Work from home when possible. Stay at home as much as you can. If you do visit indoor public places, limit the number of households in your group to a maximum of three. Wear a face covering on public transport, in shops, and when moving about in hospitality, and make sure the covering fully covers your mouth and nose. Keep windows open if you are meeting indoors, even at this time of year, and follow all advice on hygiene. Sticking to all of this is really hard, but there is no doubt whatsoever it will help keep all of us safer. So I want to end this final statement before Christmas, Presiding Officer, with a heartfelt thank you to everyone for everything you have done to help us through another exceptionally tough year. I wish everyone the happiest and safest Christmas possible, and of course a much better and brighter new year ahead.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 40 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. And I'd be grateful if members who wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak buttons now. And I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We're once again facing the unwelcome reality of this new variant and new restrictions. And everyone in this chamber has to understand and accept the frustration and anger that people across Scotland are feeling right now. But we can get through this. And like the First Minister, I want to encourage everyone to go out and get their booster jab. I've got my own scheduled for Christmas Eve. But I also want to say to a proportion of the population out there that we often focus solely on booster jabs, but there are people who have not yet had their first jab. And I want to encourage them to come forward as well. They haven't left it too late. There is no shame turning up to get your first jab now. The vaccinators simply want to protect you. So please consider doing that as well. And it is our vaccination scheme in Scotland and across the UK that has helped to keep COVID under control, and it remains our best way out of this. And it's absolutely crucial that we see the Scottish and UK governments working together constructively, fully focused on Omicron. Instead, sadly, over the last week, we've seen an unnecessary funding row that is a distraction to the task at hand. The Scottish Government originally expected £268 million, which would have still been new money, but they've now been provided with £440 million. As the Institute for Fiscal Studies made clear yesterday, this £440 million is extra money now. The Scottish Government has the funding available and Scottish businesses are crying out for it. The First Minister said this last week. Businesses are already bleeding. Every 24 hours counts. So will the First Minister tell us today when the first grants will start to reach businesses? Will it be before Christmas or will it be into the new year? Secondly, the First Minister explained in her statement that 100 ScotRail services have been cancelled due to staff absences and there are similar pressures on our emergency services and others. We raised concerns last week that self-isolation guidance for household contacts would lead to these challenges. And while well-intentioned in seeking to limit the spread of the virus, the rules could grind our transport network, our economy and public services to a halt. So given that the evidence is now showing the impact of these rules on our essential services, can the First Minister tell us if she's considered changing these rules so household contacts can end self-isolation if they have a negative test? And if not, is she confident this position is sustainable for our economy and our public services?
First Minister.
Thank you. I'll take each of these points in turn. Firstly, can I take the opportunity to agree with Douglas Ross about the importance of, if you haven't already had your first or second jag, to get those jags as quickly as possible. It is never too late, so come forward now and you will be vaccinated. And of course, the sooner you get your first jag, the sooner you'll get your second jag, and then the sooner you will also be able to get the protection of booster vaccinations. So that is a point I will reiterate and underline. Secondly, in terms of the funding, look, I'm not trying to cause a row with anybody. There are structural problems in how our funding arrangements work. We have different views across this chamber on the Barnett formula, and I'll leave those to one side. But I think what we've learned during a public health emergency is the Barnett formula is not fit for purpose. And that's a view, I think, shared by the government in Wales and Northern Ireland. So we're trying to propose constructive ways of making sure that all of us are able to discharge our public health responsibilities fairly and equitably. I welcome the announcements that the Treasury has made. The money that was announced this time last week is not new money. It is already budgeted for, largely for the health budget. So to spend it now, we have to remove money that the health service is already planning to use. The announcement made on Sunday, we think, gives us extra spending power now, money that's not already budgeted. And I'm saying today we will allocate every penny of that to business support. And between my announcement last week and a further announcement today, we will find, through very difficult budgetary decisions between now and the end of the financial year, an additional £200 million. That means that we are creating a pot of money to help businesses over the next period of £375 million. That is proportionately significantly in excess of the £1 billion for the whole UK that the Chancellor has announced today. These grants, the grants based on my announcement last week for hospitality is up to £6,800 £1,000 per hospitality business. That compares to up to £6,000 announced by the Chancellor today. We are working to get those grants to businesses just as quickly as possible, and we're working with councils to do that. Finally, Presiding Officer, on self-isolation, I mean, this is an important point, and it is one that is under ongoing consideration by the government, but the fundamental point I need to make is this. It's not self-isolation that is creating staff absences, it's the virus that's creating staff absences. And given the infectiousness of Omicron, if at this stage we don't have households isolating when one member is positive, we will have many more cases of the virus spreading, and we will compound, not alleviate, that problem. So that's the position right now, but we know and we want to migrate to something more proportionate as quickly as possible. So I can tell the Chamber that the Government is actively considering, as the booster programme meets its target, moving away from the current situation to something more proportionate. But it would be counterproductive to do that right now, because the household isolation policy at the moment remains one of the protections we have in place.
Anna Sarwar.
Officer, can I start by sending my condolences to all those that have lost a loved one? I was fortunate enough to get my booster yesterday, so can I thank Zara and all our vaccinators for their extraordinary efforts. And I appeal to people across the country, if you haven't had your first or second dose of the vaccine, please do. And if you're due a booster, then please book it. And as we head towards Christmas, I would also ask everyone to please wear a mask where appropriate, follow the advice, and also please take a lateral flow test before meeting others. This is about protecting you, your family and those around you. This is a time of anxiety for people worried about their lives and livelihoods, especially for those in the hospitality, events and leisure industries, as well as the self-employed. And people will expect and need the Scottish and UK governments to work together in the national interest at this time of crisis. Now, I note the announcements of the Chancellor today, but they simply don't go far enough. There must be an increase in the level of statutory sick pay. There must be much more significant financial support for impacted businesses and the self-employed, and for the sectors that are shut down or as good as shut down, a furlough-type scheme so we don't have businesses going bust and thousands becoming unemployed. And here in Scotland, there was believed to be around a 4,500 limit that businesses could apply for. I think the First Minister was suggesting that that perhaps will be increased to 6,800. But for many businesses, that will go nowhere near covering the impact of the losses they will face over Christmas. Also, no one should have to think twice about self-isolating due to financial pressures. Last month, 30% of people's applications for a self-isolation grant were rejected. That has peaked at as much as 50%, and with some local authorities, that's gone as high as 70% of applications for a self-isolation grant rejected. Can this be urgently reviewed? All the data published for every local authority, the eligibility criteria expanded, and the payment made much quicker. Now, finally, of course, we hope that this is the last variant, but it's highly likely that it won't be. So we must learn the lessons of Delta and Omicron. We need to build resilience and contingencies in our public services and the wider system. The Scottish and the UK governments must develop a framework and triggers for when restrictions will kick in, what they will be, and what financial package of support will come with it. So will the Scottish Government commit to urgently starting that work? And that is something that we will commit to engage with them actively on, because the ongoing uncertainty only adds to the level of anxiety and impacts negatively on people's health and well-being.
First Minister.
Again, thank you for those questions. I agree about the importance of the Scottish and UK governments working together. I think in many respects we have been and continue to work well together. In the past week and a half, I have taken part in three COBRA meetings. We have regular Four Nations discussions over and above that. We have an issue with financing that we cannot unilaterally resolve, and Anna Sarwar has narrated much of it today, and you know, the points I make in this chamber are almost identical to the points Anna Sarwar's Labour colleague Mark Drakeford is making in Wales. So we cannot unilaterally resolve these, but I hope we will get movement to find better ways forward on this. We will, after the announcements I've made today, we will have further consultation with businesses to see what additional support can be made available from the additional funding and what way it is best to make that available in. We have already given commitments to hospitality and other sectors. The additional money I'm announcing today will allow us to go further. But I agree, indeed I said it myself in my statement, it will not fully compensate businesses. That's why I think there should be the reintroduction at this stage of at least a targeted furlough scheme in order to help the most affected sectors. So we will do everything we can within our own resources and we will work with colleagues in Wales and Northern Ireland to try to get more support from the UK government. I will again take away the points on self-isolation grant. I accept the premise of that question. But again, I come back to the fact we have a limited pot of money. And so we have decisions to make about whether we try to focus that money on those most in need or spread it more thinly over a wider range of people by extending eligibility criteria. That's not an easy balance to strike, but we've put an extra £100 million into self-isolation grants, so we will again consider that. Lastly, Presiding Officer, we've already started work on longer-term health resilience, not just about the entry to and exit to restrictions. I very much hope, although I've said this before, this will be the last time we have to impose restrictions, but actually more fundamentally, as we come out of the acute phase of COVID, as it becomes more endemic in our society, how do we build the resilience in the economy and health services to deal with that? So that is work that is at an early stage. We are looking at whether our overall COVID strategic framework can be and how it can be adapted, and we may publish an updated version of this with more of a focus on health resilience in the early part of next year. And if members across the chamber have thoughts that they want to feed into that, I'm sure they would be gratefully received.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, today is the longest night of the year, and this statement will spell further darkness to an event sector that is already on its knees. They were the last to reopen, and they will be the first to be asked to close. Pantos and theatres will shut their doors. Stadiums will close. Hogmanay is cancelled again. And all of this has a knock-on effect to pubs and restaurants. They will all need to be made whole and compensated pound for pound and drink for drink. Presiding Officer, we're seeing a return to the pandemic that we first experienced last year, which puts so much pressure on so many of our key sectors and services. So I'd like to ask about PCR testing capacity. Last week, on one day alone, 64,000 tests were processed. Now, the last time this chamber was updated, our national capacity stood at just 80,000 tests a day. So can I ask the First Minister to update the chamber? Is 80,000 still the reach of our capacity in PCR processing? And is she confident that demand will not outstrip lab capacity? Because if it does, we run the risk of having key workers, particularly health workers, healthy, asked to stay at home for want of a negative PCR test.
First Minister.
Firstly, I absolutely accept the points about the impact on the event sector and the knock-on effects of that into hospitality and other parts of the economy, which is why it's so important that we do everything we can to deliver financial compensation and, of course, with others, encourage the UK government to provide more wherewithal. On the points about pandemic, I think it's really important. I think the point is legitimate, and I'll address it directly. It's not people being pinged that is causing the problem. It's people getting the virus that's causing the problem. And therefore, we need to suppress the virus. And that is just an inescapable truth, which is why that leads to some of the difficult decisions that governments are again having to take. And some of the decisions I've outlined today are in common with decisions that are being taken by governments in many other parts of Europe. Indeed, in many other parts of the UK, Wales, the Republic of Ireland, slightly further afield, has taken many of these decisions too. So it's suppressing the virus, ultimately, that will help us relieve the pressure. And self-isolation, which is where pandemic comes from, is part of the way in which we help suppress the virus. And I go back to the comments I made in response to Douglas Ross. On the issue of testing capacity, testing capacity is being increased. Lab testing capacity is being increased across the UK right now. I'll put in spice the up-to-date figures for our daily capacity. It is increasing, but it's still a bit of a moving feast, if you forgive me for using that non-technical expression. We have ample capacity right now, and in addition to the UK network capacity, we have the three regional NHS labs and pre-existing NHS capacity. However, if cases continue to soar, we will reach a point, not just in Scotland but across the UK, where we do start to challenge that capacity. That is another reason to keep a downward pressure on cases. Of course, lab capacity is only one half of our testing capacity. The sampling capacity is another. But right now, we have testing capacity, and people who have symptoms or have a positive LFD should go forward and get a PCR test, and we continue to have constructive discussions, because this is an area of very good joint working between the four nations about how we continue to increase that testing capacity as far as we possibly can.
Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, I've been contacted by a number of constituents who are concerned about their employer requiring them to attend their office as they feel they should be able to work from home. What advice would you give to my constituents in this situation, and what steps will the Scottish Government be taking to ensure employers are treating this situation as seriously as possible?
First Minister.
Employers are treating this seriously, but I would encourage very strongly all employers to do so. Where staff do have concerns, I would encourage them to raise these with their employer or their union reps where that's appropriate, or to contact the Scottish Hazards and the local authority environmental health team for advice and support. Remember, and this is a message to employers from last Friday, it is a legal requirement for businesses to take all reasonable measures to minimise the spread of COVID, and the guidance makes clear that one of the measures employers must take is to allow employees to work at home if they can. So we expect businesses and employees to take this requirement seriously. Working from home is a really important measure in controlling this more transmissible version of the virus. We continue to engage regularly with business organisations and trade unions on encouraging working from home. And lastly, I would encourage businesses to remember that suppressing the virus is in the interests of business and the economy as well. This is not a choice between protecting health and the NHS and protecting the economy. If we don't protect health, the economy will suffer. So we all have an interest in making sure that all of this guidance is followed.
Murdo Fraser to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister in her statement mentioned the issue of schools, and she'll be aware of calls in some quarters for schools in January to return to a blended learning model. I wonder if the First Minister would agree, however, that given the harm that can be caused to children being absent from the classroom environment, we should be doing all we can to ensure that schools do reopen fully in January, and will she commit to ensuring that there is no delay to the start of the new school term after the Christmas and New Year break?
First Minister.
I think I've made my views very clear on that. I want schools to reopen on schedule, and I want children to be back in school as normal. I think everybody suffered through these last 2 years, but children and young people have suffered disproportionately, particularly given the very important stage of their lives and their education that they're at. So my views on that are very, very clear. I'd say two further things, though. Firstly, I think when sometimes, particularly teachers, hear me say that, they think perhaps that I am dismissing concerns about their safety. I am not, and I want to be very clear about that. We must make sure schools are safe environments for young people and for staff, which is why the guidance published last week is so important. But secondly, and this is really a message to all of us as adults, the best way of keeping schools safe and getting schools to open normally on time is to suppress community transmission of the virus. And that is why, if for a period we as adults need to accept some further sacrifices, then if that helps us ensure normality in our schools, then while none of us will enjoy it and while it will not be easy for anybody or for businesses, that is one good reason, I think, why we should accept that and work together to get transmission down.
Thank you. Before I move to the next question, I just advise members that there's a great deal of interest in the statement, and I would be grateful for short and succinct questions and responses. Kenneth Gibson to
Thank
be followed
you,
by Jackie
Officer.
Bailey.
A number of constituents and even a member of my own staff have visited pharmacies to collect lateral flow test kits, were initially refused them as they were not registered with the pharmacy. This is even though the advice is that people don't have to be registered to receive test kits. Given that regular testing is essential to curb the spike in Omicron cases, can the First Minister advise as to the steps being taken to encourage pharmacies to hand out test kits for people who need and request them?
First Minister.
Well, LFD kits are available to everyone, and let me be clear, they don't require a prescription and they don't require the need to be registered for any form of community pharmacy services in order to obtain one from a local pharmacy. The Scottish Government wrote to the Community Pharmacy Network on the 17th of December, re-emphasising that point, along with other advice for streamlining the process for distribution to relieve pressure on community pharmacy teams who are extremely busy and who have done heroic work over the course of the pandemic. The Community Pharmacy Network is a really vital part of the public health response to COVID, and actually since the introduction of the pharmacy collect arrangements in June, they've distributed over 1.3 million packs. That's almost 10 million tests, helping keep all of us safe during this time. So let me take the opportunity to place on record my thanks to pharmacists and their teams in communities the length and breadth of the country.
Jackie Bailey to be followed by Eleanor Whittam.
A&E statistics for week ending the 12th of December are the second worst on record. And as John Thompson of the Royal College of Emergency Medicine has said, these delays will cost lives. Now, we all applaud A&E and indeed all NHS staff for their valiant efforts, but things are about to get tougher as staff absence increases due to Omicron. Can I ask the First Minister what contingency planning is in place to deal with staff shortages in the NHS and also in other essential and emergency services?
First Minister.
Firstly, accident emergency services like health services generally are under intense pressure because of this pandemic. And again, that pressure has been exacerbated because of rising cases. So we come back to the essential point here. We need to get cases coming down again to relieve that pressure. And that is the direct health pressure, but also the pressure that comes from staff absences. In the week quoted, there wasn't an exemption from isolation for NHS. There is now, so that will help to some extent to alleviate that pressure. But the only way of properly alleviating that pressure, not just in the health service, but in the economy more generally, is to get the numbers of cases down, which comes back to the reason for the difficult decisions that I'm setting out today.
Eleanor Whittam to be followed by Julian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. While the advanced funding announced by the UK Government is welcome, it falls well short of the financial support schemes required to reinforce public health messaging. It's just not sustainable that whilst the Scottish Government is responsible for protecting public health, its actions are constrained by UK Government funding decisions. Does the First Minister agree that this is yet another example of how the current funding arrangements for Scotland are entirely inadequate when it comes to responding to the impacts of the pandemic?
First Minister.
Yes, I do. And that's a view that is shared by the Labour First Minister of Wales and indeed the DUP First Minister of Northern Ireland. Whatever your views on constitutional matters, let's put those to one side right now. The Barnett formula depends on decisions being taken by the UK Government for England. That then triggers resources through consequentials for the devolved administrations. That may, and we've got different views on this, be appropriate in some circumstances, but in a public health emergency where all of us have our own responsibilities to act to protect public health and protect public health quickly, that situation self-evidently doesn't work. It's just not fit for purpose in these circumstances, and we're making that case, and I hope we are getting some understanding of that, and I hope we might be able to see some changes. We are making available as much money as we can from within our own resources. I welcome the acknowledgement by the Chancellor today that help is needed, but further help is required. And it's not just me saying that, or even Wales and Northern Ireland's governments. Many, many voices across England are saying that right now, that hospitality businesses and others are facing all the same pressures that businesses in Scotland are facing. But even after the Chancellor's announcement today, we'll be getting significantly less funding to help with that. So this is an unsustainable position, and I suspect some in the UK Government understand that. But the quicker they act, the more we'll be able to get on top of this latest phase of infection.
Julian Mackay to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The need for caution is clear and the Chancellor must bring back furlough to protect small businesses. The absence rate in schools that we've seen over the last 10 days cannot possibly be sustained in January and February without massive disruption to pupils' learning. I fully appreciate the difficulties with finance currently, but given the transmissibility of this new variant, has any new funding been identified to help schools ensure that ventilation is as effective as it can be?
First Minister.
We have, as I know Gillian Mackay is aware because she takes a very close interest in this, we made some additional funding available to local authorities some months ago for carbon dioxide monitors, allowing them to assess the ventilation. We continue to discuss with local authorities what further help and support we can provide to ensure that ventilation has been given due priority, because ventilation is not the only thing that needs to be done, but it is a really important protection, particularly in the school environment. So we are and will continue to look carefully at what further steps we can take. I want to come back, and I keep coming back to the central point here, and I know it's one Gillian Mackay absolutely understands, is that we shouldn't accept the inevitability of soaring cases and soaring staff absences as we go into January and February. If we don't do the right things now, there is a real danger of that. But that's why we're setting out the decisions we're taking right now, to try to change the future. On that, I was listening to a discussion on the radio this morning where somebody was saying that SAGE models always turn out to be wrong. Now, modelling is an imprecise science, I grant you that. But the reason the worst predictions of SAGE haven't come right in the past on all occasions is that we have acted to stop them coming to pass. And that is the key point here. We've got to act to influence what happens over the next few weeks to avoid some of the worst impacts that will otherwise confront us.
John Mason, to be followed by Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you. I very much welcome the £375 million available for business, and I note the First Minister's comments about needing a targeted furlough scheme. But I understand the Prime Minister and the Chancellor were not at the recent COBRA meetings. Does she think they really understand the seriousness of the situation? Does she know who's in control at Westminster, or is anyone in control?
First Minister.
I'm not sure that's a question I am able to answer. I might pass on that question. Look, I spoke to the Prime Minister on the telephone late on Friday. I certainly think he appreciated the seriousness of the situation. That is definitely the impression he gave me. We had a good conversation on Friday. But appreciating the seriousness of this and acting in a way to try to change the seriousness of this are two different things. And I do think it's not... And my government take responsibility for public health decisions here in Scotland. I cannot and should not second-guess the decisions the UK government take for England, although there are many voices pointing out that, just as in Scotland, action needs to be taken to get COVID under control. The interest for me and my government is that it's only when the UK government act for England that funding at scale is triggered, and that's the unsustainable, asymmetrical bit that is constraining our ability to act. So I hope we do see the Prime Minister, the Chancellor, the entirety of the UK government treat this challenge with the seriousness it merits, because frankly all of us need them to do that.
Sandesh Gulhani, to be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you. We know coronavirus is airborne, not droplet spread. We know Omicron causes differing symptoms from the classical triad. It has an R of 4, an attack rate of 50%, evades double vaccines, and thus can be unwittingly spread by people. My question is, given that it's our responsibility to protect the Scottish NHS workforce, will the First Minister upgrade healthcare workers' PPE from a surgical mask to FFP2 and 3?
First Minister.
I'll take advice on the clinical requirements for PPE in the health service. I've done that throughout and respond accordingly. The guidance on PPE, if memory is still serving me correctly here, is on a four nations basis. So we are using the same grading of PPE in different circumstances. But if clinicians say to me that something additional is required there, then of course, as a non-clinician, I will listen to that and I will act on that.
Christine Graham, to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. What with vaccines, boosters and lateral flow tests, the role of Test and Protect has to some extent disappeared from sight. So I welcome Test and Protect prioritising high-risk settings such as hospitals and care homes, but would the First Minister also remind us all of the importance of Test and Protect generally and keeping the app active?
First Minister.
Test and Protect, I hope for most people it's out of sight, because that means we won't be getting contacted by it, but it is doing incredible work every single day to help break the chains of transmission of this virus. So I would take the opportunity, as invited by Christine Graham, to remind people of the importance of it. If they contact you because you have tested positive, make sure you fill in the details that they will ask you for, so that your contacts can be given information as quickly as possible. And if you are contacted as a contact of someone who's positive, make sure you follow the advice that you give. That is really important. And of course, to end on Christine Graham's final point there, the app is really important. So if you downloaded the app to start with, go and check that it is still active, that you've got it properly switched on and activated. Because if you do that, then that absolutely helps Test and Protect to do its job and make sure people are getting the protection that they need.
Faisal Chowdhury, to be followed by CoCab Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Delayed discharge continues to affect many of my Lothian constituents due to care staff shortage. One 82-year-old man from Kirkliston has been stuck in hospital for almost 3 months now. as there is lack of care homes available to take residents who require local authority-funded places. Can I ask the First Minister, as we witness the surge of COVID cases, how will the Scottish Government solve the staff shortage and increase funded places so that social care package can be delivered for many of my constituents in Lothian?
First Minister.
It's a really important question. Delayed discharges are not in the interest of people who are delayed in hospital, but they're not in the interest of the wider health system either. So we're working hard to try to reduce delayed discharge. I'll come on to the issues that are compounding that challenge at the moment. But one of the key things we have done, the Health Secretary reported this to Parliament in the recent past, is provide funding for the recruitment of 1,000 additional workers to help with exactly the problem that the member outlines. Of course, all of these problems right now are being compounded by staff absence due to the virus. That's happening in social care, the health service, and across all sectors of our public services and the economy, which comes back to the essential point I keep coming back to today. We've got to get this virus under control. It won't solve all of these problems, but it will at least mean that we're not exacerbating them by the absences that we're seeing right now. And that's one of the big factors behind the decisions that we set out today, not least the cancellation of large-scale events to reduce the pressure on the ambulance service, for example, who are already struggling with some of these issues.
Co-Cab Stewart to be followed by Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's so important that everyone eligible comes forward for vaccination. So I would like to ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government is doing to encourage the uptake of the vaccine and boosters in our communities of Black, Asian, ethnic minority, heritage and culture.
First Minister.
Well, that's a really important question because it's vital that we get uptake of boosters high across the whole population, but that we make sure that within particular communities that we know have been disproportionately affected by COVID, that uptake is high too. And Black, Asian and ethnic minority communities are certainly a key grouping there. We're working with health boards. Health boards have inclusion plans within the vaccination programme, setting out how they will actively offer vaccination to groups that we know face barriers to uptake. The location of clinics are often decisions around the location of clinics are often taken with that very much in mind. So clinics in places of worship, for example, Glasgow Central Mosque being not the only one, but probably the most prolific example of that across Glasgow in particular. The ambulance service is also providing mobile outreach units to try to get into communities that have been harder to reach. We also are working closely with organisations like BMIS, which is the national umbrella body supporting ethnic minorities, voluntary sector groups in Scotland. So there's a whole range of work that has been done, and I know health boards will keep at this for as long as is necessary.
Sue Webber to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's imperative that there are enough personnel to run offshore oil and gas facilities, but equally that there are enough competent personnel in all of the safety critical roles and emergency response teams at these installations. We're still learning about Omicron, and we've heard about that today. But failure to act swiftly could result in the shutdown of offshore installations or the shutdown of onshore terminals, which would result in a security of supply issue for Scotland and the wider UK. Will the First Minister support the oil and gas industry with a more flexible approach and a strategy that can be deployed quickly to focus on the protection of the most vulnerable, yet retain personnel on their installations to ensure they can continue to power the UK?
First Minister.
Yes is the short answer to that. I mean, we work with different sectors to make sure that these challenges that are being faced right now with staff absences are being mitigated as far as possible. There are exemption arrangements in place for critical sectors, and we keep that under review. Officials and ministers engage with different sectors, and I'll make sure that we are engaging closely with oil and gas to address the particular concerns that have been raised.
Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glans.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. At last week's NHS Grampian MSP COVID update, we discussed the challenge of people with health and attention not presenting with conditions that require investigation or treatment. And while the situation was beginning to ease, I'm concerned the upsurge in Omicron will again discourage those in most need of healthcare from seeking help. So what assurance can the First Minister give that everything is being done to encourage people to both make and keep appointments with GPs and others while recognising the huge pressures facing health services once again?
First Minister.
This is a really important point as well. Obviously, the NHS and all parts of the NHS are under severe and increasing pressure right now, but the NHS remains open to people who need it. And if anyone needs to contact their GP or other parts of the health service, they should do that. We have worked hard to try to ensure GP capacity for medical care is preserved. So, for example, that is one of the reasons why we have deliberately limited the involvement of GPs in the COVID vaccination programme. They've not had no involvement, let me stress, and we're very grateful to them for what they have done, but we have not relied overly on GPs to deliver the vaccination programme. We're also increasing funding for the expansion of multidisciplinary teams, and we have provided additional funding to primary care to help specifically support services through the winter to try to increase the availability of face-to-face appointments as much as possible, but also recognise that for many reasons, not just COVID protection, but for many other reasons, patients will benefit from other ways of accessing their GP online or telephone services. So we'll continue to work with and support GPs as much as we can.
Pam Duncan-Clancy to be followed by Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Constituents have contacted me concerned about the distance they need to travel to get the COVID vaccinations. Many don't live near vaccination sites and don't drive, and so they're reliant on public transport, which in Glasgow is patchy, especially in the north of the city. This not only poses financial challenges to low-income households, but can also be inaccessible and distressing for some disabled people. One constituent has said that they're afraid of using public transport due to the risk of catching COVID. Can the First Minister outline what plans are in place to ensure people can get their vaccines closer to home and where they do have to travel, that there is affordable, accessible and safe transport available to get them to the COVID vaccination centre?
First Minister.
I think Pam Duncan-Glancy illustrates very well there a challenge that I've articulated actually on occasion in the Chamber, not least when I've been understandably challenged by others to have more mass vaccination centres. Mass vaccination centres do have a part to play, but we need a balance of provisions so that we've got much more community availability as well. That's why we've tried to get that balance between big scale, sometimes more remote places, and smaller scale places that are easier for people to access in their own communities. That balance is difficult to get absolutely right. My advice to people who are struggling to get to a vaccination appointment is to contact the helpline to seek advice on how they can get that vaccination in a way that is more accessible. There are a variety of appointments. You don't have to book an appointment in your own area. There are different ways now of booking appointments. We'll also make sure health boards are making sure that any appropriate assistance is given to people who really struggle to get to vaccination appointments. So we'll ensure that that continues to be borne in mind.
Claire Adamson to be followed by Craig Hoy. I'll go to Mr. Hoy, Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Public health messaging remains a crucial part of the fight against Omicron. Given that recent YouGov polling found that less than 2% of Scots understood the Full Facts acronym, how will the government ensure that any new COVID guidance is communicated effectively? And whenever possible, will the First Minister ensure that these communications are consistent through the adoption of a Four Nations approach to messaging?
First Minister.
We do adopt Four Nations approaches. Some of the advertising right now is on a Four Nations basis. Just as the UK Government would reserve its right to say what I'm about to say as well, I reserve the right, and there have been periods in the pandemic where we've not thought the messages from the UK Government were appropriate or right, and therefore we've had messaging that we thought was appropriate for Scotland. I try, and the government tries, to communicate as clearly as possible. We don't always get that right. We test messages. We learn from that. The facts advice, we certainly will learn from that. That particular campaign is no longer in use because not all of the components of it are currently what we are advising people to do, although we're getting back closer to that at the moment. So I take, sometimes I'm criticised for taking it too seriously. I take the whole public communication aspect of this really seriously, because I know how important it is, and we will absolutely learn any lessons as we go about how we improve that.
Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Since the JCVI advice now includes pregnant women in the at-risk category, can the First Minister provide an update on the uptake of the COVID vaccine by pregnant women?
First Minister.
Well, I certainly very much welcome the JCVI's recent advice, which moved pregnant women into the at-risk group for COVID vaccination. And I think that demonstrates the importance of women getting vaccinated when they're pregnant to protect them, but also their babies, against what we know are the risks of COVID in pregnancy. In terms of uptake, uptake amongst pregnant women remains much lower than it is for non-pregnant women, but it is increasing. The most recent data published by Public Health Scotland, which covers September and October, shows that uptake has been more similar in these months in pregnant women compared to the general female population than was the case previously. So the fact that it is improving is encouraging, but I would continue to urge all pregnant women who have not already done so to book a vaccination as soon as possible. It is really important to protect your own health, but it's also really important to protect the health of your baby.
Thank you. That concludes First Minister's statement, COVID-19 update. My apologies to those members I was unable to take. There'll be a short pause before the next item of business.